Trends in business, society, demographics present enterprise with new opportunities for growth and innovation.
Mega trends like digital consumers, emerging economies, sustainability, healthcare and smarter organizations are changing consumer mindset and business models alike. Led by technology, enterprise will have to leverage more mega trends to build the enterprise of tomorrow.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, respected dignitaries and dear student managers. Welcome to the afternoon session of second day of National Business Convention 2016 of Sri Balaji Society, focusing on emerging challenges of business environment. Welcome to the fiesta of learning. Welcome to the corporate interface. Success only goes with them who have the courage to stand against all odds and emerge as a champion at the end. With this present thought, I, Yogesh Kumar Barange, will be your master of ceremony for the today's afternoon session.
We are honored to have amongst us an accomplished leader with multi-faceted experience in human resource, Mr. Pratap, Senior Director, Human Resource, Maersk Line India Private Limited. Now, I would request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director in Charge, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to welcome our guests with a bouquet of flowers.
Thank you, ma'am. Since morning, eminent leaders from corporate world have guided us to a path of knowledge where we came across VUCA, artificial intelligence, robotics, Internet of Things, skills and qualities required to face the emerging challenges in business environment.
The journey of success should be step by step, and this National Business Convention is yet another step to be in a synchronization with the transforming landscape of the business environment. We all have gathered here to meet and interact with eminent leaders of the corporate world who have climbed the ladder of corporate success. Corporate leaders from various sectors are here to share their experience and enhance our learning.
May I now call upon Student Manager Abhishek Kumar Kashyap to introduce our guest.
Thanks, Yogesh. A very good afternoon to one and all present over here. I, Abhishek Kashyap, Student Manager, BIMM, feel extremely honored to welcome Mr. Pratap Ji, Senior Director HR at Maersk, responsible for global human resource for services business in India, China, and Philippines. Sir has amazing, rich, and diverse experience spanning for more than over 25 years. Mr. Pratap has spent half of his career in IT, ITES organizations like GE, Genpact, and Tata's. Earlier, Sir was with FMCG industries with brand like Marico, Pepsi, and Blowplast. His area of passion includes leadership development, executive coaching, teaching at various universities across the world. He is an avid angler too. Sir has received the Maersk Global State Award and Genpact Top Award called the Platinum Award as a recognition of his leadership. Mr. Pratap has multiple degrees from prestigious universities in areas like law, labor law, international law from ILS Law College. And also, he has attended masters in personal management and human resource from SIBM Pune. So, it is indeed a pleasure to have you amongst us. We all student managers are looking for insights given by you. So, the podium is yours.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Superb. Good afternoon. Roughly about 800-850 odd you, right? So it's great. Thanks for inviting me for this session. There are two or three things which I can do. I would just take a poll initially just to look at what is the real need. there is one perspective to generally talk about what's happening in the international business. Is that what you're looking for? Because then one could go to terrorism, to, you know, populism, to Brexit, to, you know, the slowdown in Europe, to the resurgence of the US, or are you looking at anything specific from the transportation and the logistics and the shipping industry? The second? Okay. But I hear more of the second as an option. But we will try and see some aspects, what it would relate, I would touch upon. Okay, so I get a feel of... So what I'm going to do, let's just look at... I hardly have about 4 or 5 slides. The point is for you all to understand, how does this kind of a conglomerate pass through an era, especially the last 2 years, with volatility in the market, right? So a quick introduction. I represent the Maersk Group. We are predominantly into energy, engineering, and mainly shipping, right? So if you look at our flagship brand is Maersk Line. And I'm going to ask a lot of questions, guys. Okay? Out of the close to 40 billion plus business, close to 23 billion is revenue of Maersk Line as a business. It's a significantly tough business. It is about moving containers from one place to the other. We are the market leaders. To a great extent, you know, we as a company call ourselves people who enable global trade. Yeah? So we'll come to the details later. Okay? The second, very, very small business, luckily to be small during these times, when you run a business like oil. We're not as big as a Shell or a Exxon or any of these large oil giants. We're a small player in the Maersk, in the oil industry. Then we have a terminal business. What is a terminal business? Terminal business is a place where transshipments would happen. You have seen these large truck yards, container yards, right, next to the port. So what happens? India, let's say, if a Maersk Alabama comes to a Nausheva port, roughly it has about 8,500 containers. At least 60 to 80% gets unloaded in Mumbai. And similar containers get loaded in Mumbai. Right? And the ship leaves in less than 24 hours. So for that kind of a cargo execution to happen, you can imagine the kind of backend which is required, right? That's the kind of speed, because 1 hour of anchoring in the Nausheva port, I'm told, is close to 3 lakh rupees rent just to park the ship. I mean, that's the kind of money we are talking about. Okay, so terminals, we do have terminal business across. We are the third largest terminal company in the world. We recently acquired the 23rd largest terminal business about 6 months back. For folks who have been reading on that, we have also got into some challenge related to one of the ports, operating, not operating kind of a thing, but some tough times there. Maersk Drilling. Drilling is a platform business which primarily gets into specializing in drilling oil. And these are very, very long businesses. Sometimes, you know, what is the average time does it take to get oil? Any idea? Roughly? Sorry? It could even take up to 20 years. Because you need to get across and first start doing geological surveys, look at different kinds of rocks, analyze stuff, and then get into. And you can imagine many a times, most of the investment after 60% goes waste because there's no oil there. So it's not an easy business at all to do drilling. So what we do drilling as a turnkey business for other companies. And we are also not only experts in vertical drilling, we also experts in horizontal drilling, which is much more challenging in this space. And then, of course, we have more about shipping services business put together, supply services, tankers, Svitzer and Damco. Like for example, Damco is a supply chain solutions company. We do global freight forwarding through that company, right? Svitzer does a lot of turnkey work in high seas. We move oils or any large liquids through the tanker business. And of course, supply services is the conduit between rigs and the shore, many a times because of the distance, carrying a lot of goods related to the engineering in deep sea. Now, having said that, and why did I give you a little elaborate introduction of our businesses, is, you know, I'm going to talk about, or rather ask questions to you, if you look at the last 2 years, what do you think each of these businesses did? You know, I'm not expecting you to answer me exact profit numbers and things like that, but did it go up? If it went up, why? Did it go down? You know, things like that. You know, otherwise, how will you get to know what's happening in the international business, right? So let's start with Maersk Line. It is a container shipping company. We own or lease about 615 large ships. Most of it is owned by us. The latest Triple E vessels would cost close to $400 to $450 million per ship, US dollars. Right? So that's the kind of significantly high capital intensive building business. Right? So I'll give you, in 2014, this business did a turnover of about 23 to 23.5 billion and made closely to a profit of 2.34 billion. That's a good 10 to 12% ROIC. So the question is, in the last 1.5 years, which is 2015 and 2016, where do you think this business is? Whoever is going to speak, just raise the hand and I will request them to answer. The question is, 23 billion business moves containers across the globe. It is like a conveyor belt of world trade, right? In 2014, made a profit of 2.34 billion with a revenue of about 23.5 billion, right? Where do you think that business moved in 2015, and where do you think
the businesses? Any guesses?
So,
yeah?
I think from 2015, by the slowdown of Chinese economy. So I think I'm assuming that Maersk Line is a major transporter of China to different countries, exporting goods. So I think that if considering that, China will exporting will be low. So I think it would have slowed down.
Any rough estimate? How much? Roughly? What percentage of the business? Hard to guess. Okay, that's fine. Any other answers?
Yeah.
So I guess it could have increased because buying power was increased as Chinese economy slowed down. And I don't think the exports from China has decreased. And similarly, even India has also started to export more in wherever the China was depleting. So I guess at least around 40 to 50% it should have increased than what it was last year.
One of the cautions I want to give you, and I've seen, you know, students when they talk from India, most of their mindset is very Indian, right? It is extremely important to get a global perspective. So just a caution for anybody who is going to answer. I'll come back to that, yeah.
With a CAGR of 3.7%, this business will obviously going to grow in future. The CAGR of this international cargo and logistic business is somewhere around 3.7%.
Right.
Okay, so you're also saying that it would have increased. Great.
So,
any different options? One I heard low, two I heard increase. Any other hands?
I do think it's going to increase because if you see, if we consider Maersk Line, is the market leader, world leader in logistics. So the biggest port on the planet is itself established in China. So that means the commerce in China is going to increase. So the business is going to increase. If you see here in India, we have 3 to 4 ports here which are under development. So this business is doing good. That's why the ports all over the world are, you know, the governments are trying to develop them.
Okay.
So I think so, it's going to go up.
Okay, good. Now let me just shift the question. What are the large global changes which you are not considering till now in the answers which I've heard?
So one reason could be that Iranian Chabahar port has been the sanctions from the Iran and been lifted up, and India has helped Iran to develop the Chabahar port, which was considered an impasse in that territory. So what I think is that when the Chabahar port has been reopened for trade, so that it must have been as an aid to the logistics, international.
Yeah, we do about 10 to 20% volumes
of global trade, roughly, right? I'm including bulk as tankers as well. So small ports like this, it is minuscule what it can make or break in a company. I'm just saying that there are some big frames which you guys are missing. And when you look at international business, you need to look at it. So the first clue from my side, out of 23 billion which we spent, right, 6 billion we used to spend in crude oil. We are the second largest crude oil consumers after the US military.
Yeah.
So crude oil prices have come down, so maybe
the
cost of operation will reduce.
Very good. Cost of operation significantly has reduced. 2015
early, please have a seat. 2015 early, we saved close to a billion purely because of the crude oil prices. But then what happens next? What happens in a market when one of the main stuff like crude prices are going down? Would a company like Maersk able to enjoy the benefits till cows come home?
If it is 12% now, ROI, it could have reached to 14-15%.
Yeah, but it has never reached, which is the question which I am asking. Now, one more thing which you need to consider, and if you want to know the market, yeah?
Cargo from the airline significantly
going to
rise as well.
Yeah, but what goes in shipping
is anything weighing more than 150 kilos. That is what is shipped. Anything less than that can be shipped, but it can also go by cargo. So we are talking about 99% of the business which is more than 150 kilos. Normally people do 10 containers, 15 containers, so it's all for that kind of good movement. Okay, so to come back, because we need to cover each of the other businesses as well. In our kind of industry, the capacity, when you really want to look at the industry, that is one frame which you need to consider. In shipping, today, we are standing on 32% excess capacity, which means that latest ships have come into, for whatever various reasons, carbon footprint, economies of scale, all of that, right? And hence, 32% extra capacity. Now, what happens when your crude prices go beyond a point down is it starts a pricing war. And in the pricing war, March of 2016, between Europe and Asia, saw a rate of a 40-foot container moving from China to Europe at as least as $700. The average price of a container 40 feet from Europe to Asia 5 years back was around $4,500 to $5,000. So the question is, how do you make money when your product prices are constantly decreasing? Between 2015 and 16, there has been a 62% reduction in your product prices. So I'm just trying to give a flavor in terms of what an industry could go through. And You know, so that's something which is interesting. We'll come to more exciting stuff. What do you think happened to Maersk Oil? It should be a very clear-cut answer, right? Maersk Oil went through significant challenges. What do you think are the parameters in an oil business? Yeah?
The crude oil prices were near to $120.
Yeah.
Then it rolled back down to $28 because of slow economy of Chinese, then ban on Iran, then introduction of shale oil in the market, and then OPEC countries,
right,
which were not like United. After this, it again started to roll back up to around $50 to $55. Then it started to roll back down. Currently the prices are like $42-$43 per barrel. So now the excessive supply of oil is again hitting the market.
Absolutely right. The question which I am asking is, which oil company can still make money when the prices of oil itself is gone by one third or even one fourth? Perfect. Who do you think is the, right? No, shale gas is one aspect, but you need to look at production of oil as a cost, right? So we have closed down one of our, you know, North Sea facilities, or closing down. Why? Because the production of oil there is more than what we can, the cost is more than what we can make. But how much do you think a Saudi would be making oil at? $8 to $10 per barrel. So they are still making about $35 per barrel still, right? But the challenge is, if you go to the, you know, Tanjung Palepas, you know, port or close by the port, you will see the number of oil tankers which are standing. Why? Because there is no demand beyond a point, and all the storage facilities next to the port are still full. So we are seeing some huge changes there, right? So Maersk Oil as a business for us is going through some very, very tough times. Great time to buy. A lot many smaller people are moving out, or there are businesses where you can do joint ventures in terms of with the governments in terms of exploring, but investing big time into buy an oil business is not the right thing to do, right? Just because our shares are a Maersk Group shares, and because we are in oil and drilling, that has affected our share prices significantly. So sometimes when you look at international business, you also need to look at what kind of grouping is the best from a shareholder perspective. And currently, we are planning a split in the group because of some of these realities. Very soon in August, you will get to know the news, but at least whatever I'm saying is in the public domain today. Otherwise, I'm not talking anything else. What about terminal business? What do you think would be happening to terminal business? Yeah, I mean, there is a slowdown, definitely. But please understand, whoever is in the market who is going to really focus on what unique things you can give to the customer still will manage to get a decent price. So there are highly sophisticated speed moments of terminals, right? If you are able to give that kind of speed and end-to-end transportation, not just from the port, but also to make sure that from the factories, which means inland, both the terminal movements and the inland, those businesses are good. 2014, we had made $700 million profit for that business, 2015 rather. 2016 would be a challenge because of the significantly lower rates. But how does a company like us benefit? Because we have container business and terminals, which means that we could definitely make sure that we give a good rate between, and also make sure that we benefit other competition. If I am a terminal person, I would also make sure that Maersk Line's competition is also given challenging rates, so that terminal is still able to utilize the capacity which they have. I spoke about drilling. Drilling, because you are a third-party driller, because you do turnkey, whether there is excess oil production, none of those companies would really want to invest in drilling unless there are some work happening, because things will change 2 years down the line. So work for oil production in a new facility may come after 10 years. Those work will continue. But work in terms of, I mean, things could get postponed. It's like in corporates, when the slowdown happens, training is the first thing to get postponed, right? This is similar. So because our expertise in horizontal drilling, there is good amount of work which we do. But the best part of this is that the group has both oil and drilling, which is relatively small for the businesses. And I'm not going to get into the other business in detail, but I just thought it is good to just give you a flavor in terms of what to look at when you look at any other industry. Before companies come into the campus, etc., when you look at fast-moving consumer goods, oil and gas, there would be many industries, right? So there is a way which you need to really look at different frames and then connect the larger picture before, you know, because just sometimes looking at the balance sheet is not good enough. Okay, I'm not very sure, you know, how much of that. I just felt as a second frame, what I should touch upon is, when I'm sitting there, you know, what are the kind of industries which I would focus in terms of the next 5 to 10 years? What's happening? And what I've tried to do is to look at related to the transportation industry. And you know, what are some of the things which are happening, right? I'm not going to read all of those. I'm sure it is, you know, readable from there. But please look at one aspect. The intelligent machines which are replacing human labor is a very, very big thing which is happening, right? I don't know how many of you read read the PwC 4th Industrial Revolution report. If you have not read it, you should definitely read. We are talking about, in a place like India, the biggest student unrest which is going to happen in 2022, because what skills and competencies are required by that time, 64% is not being taught. The biggest student unrest is going to be in 2022. Globally, there are other challenges. You know, there are age-related challenges to China and Japan, right? There is much lesser working population in Europe. Luckily, we have started seeing US building its momentum, and pretty much by end of the year, post the elections, you know, I'm sure it would take in another big leap, which is good, which is great. But China, not very sound. I heard some Chinese comments, but the domestic market beyond a point is just not increased. You know, I would not be surprised if they would again do RMB, you know, re-evaluation. If that has to happen, then I don't think it is going to be good. But UK will go through some tough time, but I think India and China, the exports will definitely be positive because of that. So, you know, these are some of the stuff. I mean, you know, we talked about the population demographics, the energy, the automobile industry is going to be one industry which is going to constantly grow. But provided, you know, I'm sure there will be a lot of Tesla related technology which is going to come into. I mean, you know, I'm sure you would have read about how many hours of driverless car and one accident, which that too, human error, right? So things like that. So a lot of focus in terms of manufacturing, even if it's for India or globally, you will find there is significant amount of work going to happen in that space. So the whole question is, what is the kind of areas, you know, together with your MBA education, which you are willing to learn? I mean, students now started learning robotics, right? That's going to be a huge thing. But the thing is, beyond a point when we grow, the question is, how are you going to get into things like that? We'll come to some specific areas where I feel people should really look at. I mean, I'm told an Indian who knows to speak Mandarin will be 1,000 times more richer. Right? I don't know if anyone sitting in this class is actively trying to learn Mandarin. right? I mean, you know, think about certain things which you can do. You can just download an app called Pleco and learn on your own. Believe you me, you will be 1,000 times more richer if you can speak Mandarin. You can take that word from me. So it is extremely important to think about, you know, so the energy sector is going to, the renewable energy sector is going to really grow. So that's an area for us to really look at. Let's quickly move to, look at some of the technologies which I just spoke. This is something which in 2013, 3 years before, McKinsey had done, you know, a survey just to look at what does the future hold for shipping, right? There are significant aspects in terms of renewable energy and the movement. Lot of work in the advanced material, 3D printing, energy storage, lot of work in advanced robotics, cloud, IoT, mobile internet, and all of this is affected. For example, today our ability to track a container every second is so high. Why am I touching upon all this? Is these are the areas where new jobs are, right? For example, sitting in Mumbai, all our 615 ships are tracked, not just for piracy or anything else, just tracked in terms of the speed they are going. Because as one of your friends said, leadership in terms of using crude oil is very important. The speed of the ship is tracked sitting in an office in Mumbai. And if the ship is going beyond a particular knot, then a call goes to the captain in terms of checking what it is. So that's the kind of technology and work which is happening. And why I am so interested and exciting in the transportation, this aspect of the sector, is a lot of disruption is yet to happen in this sector. And hence, there is a lot of jobs provided you are at the forefront of some of those technologies. For example, today you can go to a bank, and you don't need to go to a bank, and everything you can sit in front of your computer and do it, right? An airline ticket, booking, cancellation, changing, everything done in less than 5 minutes. But you cannot do that in a shipping space. You can still go through a website and probably book a container, but the entire end-to-end in terms of specifics cannot be done. So companies like us are on a significant online transformation journey. So students like you who are coming, who has significant focus on the disruption-related stuff, projects done around, you know, in that, are huge assets for companies like this in this space. So hence, just take a note of some of the technologies which have been told. So which means if industry's IT is so old, then the movement is directly onto cloud and not to anything in between. So just make sure that, you know, your knowledge in terms of these new technologies which are coming out there is something which is really focused upon. So that's something which, there is a full report of this available. If anybody wants, I can share that. But very, very important to analyze and see what is the reality in 2016. Because these are the kind of things which you will get into discussions with the companies when they come here onto the campus. Right? Okay, so we spoke about a little bit of Maersk Line, but I just thought we will dwell a little more in terms of a couple of things. One, what do you think the supply-demand scenario is? As I said, 32% excess capacity, hence significant amount of price issues. Unless you are in a position to give a unique value proposition to the customer, you will only give movement of goods from place A to place B. There are many people, they are willing to do it at half your cost. So, you know, innovation and thoughts in terms of how would you be unique in terms of facilitating global trade. So you need to think you're facilitating global trade rather than thinking you're moving a container from A to B, point number one. Dip in global container volumes, significant amount of dip, pricing issues, but you know, you need to really make sure that the governments are working. Like, for example, the moment GST will be cleared very soon in India, you would see significant amount of business rising. I mean, one thing which you really need to do is to really pray to see if that happens, because of course it has some pros and cons, and I think that's the reason why the debate is going on for so long. But believe you me, that would change, right? I mean, this is the only industry, guys. India is the only industry today. I mean, GDP figures which are mentioned out there are at least on an average 2 to 3% or 2 to 2.5% bloated. Any economy, right? We're talking about Europe roughly about 2 to 2.1%. And India is the only market where it is at least touching 6.5%. I mean, we talk about 7.5%, that's not reality. So the amount of growth this sector, I mean, even comparing to China, which is going to face and facing right now, is significantly high. But that means that it would require talent which are so sharp in some of this stuff. Which is why the whole generic outlook versus specialist outlook, I think the specialist outlook is going to gain much, much more focus. So in these areas, look at what is your niche, where does your passion lie, and go much, much more deeper into that, because that makes a difference when you speak to a corporate. You know, and then if that matches with what the corporate is looking at, you will be the number one person to get the job. So please make sure that you kind of get on. Okay, freight rates I talked about in terms of reduction, but industry consolidation, that's something which you really need to understand. I don't know how many of you are looking at shipping, but the latest consolidation which has happened out there is a giant like UASC, which is a Middle East shipping company, recently merged with Hapag-Lloyd. So we have started seeing consolidation of shipping companies, because you just cannot afford with a 32% capacity to still run these assets and have, you know, the assets with you like that. So people have started kind of merging. Recently, CMSCGM acquired a company called NOL. In fact, the EU just gave the approval last week for that. We saw in China the two big shipping companies, which are half government owned, which is Costco and China Shipping, they just got merged. So in this year, we have seen three large consolidations which are happening. Now, what happens when consolidations happen? There is at least 20 to 30% of excess manpower. And then the whole question is, if you're looking at this industry, then you really need to know, you know, where does this lie? I mean, I remember 6 years back going into this industry, and we had a setup which had about 8,000 people. Today, we are 13,000 people. Initially, internationally, to sell these roles were not easy, you know, BPO, whatever. Today, 80% of the frontline activity is done. In fact, we closed the books of Maersk sitting in the service, Global Services Division in Pune. I mean, this place, right? So the point which I'm talking about is that a lot of mindset in terms of what roles and where should be taken out. You should look at the experience which you're going to gain. Is that going to be worth? I don't know how many of you all heard this whole concept of the orange world. There will not be so many permanent jobs anymore in the future. Give it another 5 years, people would have 50% of part-time jobs. Can you ever imagine that scenario? 50% of the corporate jobs, people would want to do part-time. Let more millennials come into, like you all, into the business. You would prefer working, and even corporates would prefer working, wherein, you know, you can work from home, it would be per day kind of scenarios. So this whole flexible workforce is a big thing. And believe you me, try and build your niche and be prepared for that world, and not thinking like conventional jobs I need to have, etc. You know, people are going to significantly continue to get educated, because your government educational systems and some of the others would definitely be running behind what the industry requires. So your constant continuing education is going to be a big part. That could be virtual education or anything like that, but people are going to work part-time and continuously learn. And if people are proactively welcoming that and creating a mindset to work in those kind of environment, it will be great. A lot of professionals would want to work only part-time. And, you know, we've just started a program called you know, a second career, right? We're inviting women leaders who have taken a break of 5 years, 7 years to come back and take roles. We train them for about 6 months, give them projects, and most of them are clearing, and then they get into permanent roles with us. All of them are, they have, I mean, right now they've taken a break, they say they don't want. I mean, we would come work for about 4 days or 3 days, and they're happy, and they're doing some fantastic jobs, part of global projects. But so we are seeing a trend in terms of people not being the old class passionate about having permanent jobs. So try and, you know, read more about this whole orange world concept and try and get adjusted. Market disruptors, I'm sure all of you are watching so many of these startups, right? Fortunately, there are a great number of startups both in the Valley, US and China. Unfortunately, there are also a lot number of stuff which are closing down. Yesterday, you would have heard about layoffs started in Flipkart, right? So what needs to be really looked at is get into companies where there is so much of work. Don't go behind brands, guys. I mean, if you are interested in mobile internet technology from an ad space, look at the way InMobile is growing, right? I mean, so right now is the time to gain your specialist experience and try and do. I mean, gone are the days where, I mean, you look at China, right? Tencent, Huawei, and which is the third company? Alibaba. These are the three big names any Chinese IT person would love to join. 90% of, or 95% of the China IT crowd joins in garage companies and really built it up. Far many entrepreneurial folks who are out there. So I'm just saying, try and gain experience and be open to move into organizations. They may not be in a position to afford to come to campus, but try and see how you can get some of those smaller companies, because that is where future experience lies, what is required. With your leadership, if you can get into those kind of setups, I think life is going to be much, I mean, you will be much, much, you know, faster worth in 5 years to come as a leader in such larger companies. Because the biggies like us, we are taking time to get into the new world. Luckily, some of us who run that in India, like for example, we have a trade finance division. In the last 8 months, we have given loans to about $40 million loans to our customers, and we are building that startup. But not many companies who are old, significant brick and mortar has that agility and, you know, that entrepreneurship and, you know, all of that. So hence, always look for companies who are disrupting out there. So people interested to look at disruption in this space, go and look at websites like shipster.com, shipstr.com, or Flexport, you know, flexport.com. You will see how they have created a virtual marketplace without anything in hand, which means they don't own ships. They just create a virtual marketplace, you know, by giving the best rates and connecting with the right customers. Without a single, I mean, that entire company, Flexport, is today with an investment of about 26 million, of course, all given by VCs, but I don't think they would have used more than 5 to 8 million till now, but really working in terms of additional technologies. Look at the kind of experience one would gain. I mean, this is just, started by a guy called Ryan, and of course, there are a couple of very senior people who are with him. But the point is that there are opportunities like that. I don't need to get into the details, but I just thought, and also there's a company called, I think, Heaven Incorporation, H-E-A-V-E-N-I-N-C. So if you really are interested in the transportation space, go and check out those disruptors. You will get to learn more about that. And what are we doing about it? We know that we do not want to get disrupted. We have an eye on each of these guys, and we would be the ones who will disrupt the market in a big way. So there is a global simplification project currently running for the last year and a half. It will run another 6 to 8 months, post which what we are expecting is to significantly move up in the online journey. Today, the travel agent is not relevant at all in the airline space, right? In shipping, today there is somebody called the global and freight forwarding agent. We feel that we are going to enter into eating a lot of that market and make sure that consumers through online get the best of rates through us. So then again, there is a connect if you're looking at in the transportation industry to look at what is the kind of online experience which you are going to bring on in your parallel studies to make sure that you are able to play a role there. Did I press the wrong one? Yeah. Okay, so I'm not very sure how much of time I have, but I just would now want to pause a little bit before I get into this slide and to just do a Q&A. Because what is also more important is to, you would have some questions based on what I've been discussing till now. So what kind of questions do you have? Anything related to this industry, you know, transportation, shipping, logistics. So let me just take some questions before I move to the slide. Yeah?
So recently, Maersk, your company has connected India and Africa with the least shipping time in the market.
Yeah.
So how could I have been any better if the Ram Setu project had been implemented, like in terms of revenue and growth in the shipping industry, and also the impact of the newly constructed, that is the second canal that's done in the Panama.
Yeah.
That's a bigger one. So what is the impact of that, and what would have been the possible impact if the Ram Setu project had been implemented?
So a couple of things. One, do you have any idea how much time it took for the canal to be rebuilt?
Around 15 to 10 years. I'm not exactly sure.
Around that much of time. Yes, I think the spend was about 7 billion.
Yes, sir.
Right? Now, how much of time and money would have been wasted in the so many years for people who moved around stuff through other places, right? We are one of the first few to quickly gain. I mean, the fees we pay to pass through is high. So yes, for us, reliability of our services is extremely important. Maersk is known in the market for high reliability, right? And we would want to continue that edge. So hence, we've kind of created the Africa and all of those.
Yes.
But beyond a point, you are only a container company. Certain other stuff is nothing related with you directly. You may be able to influence, but in that influence scenario, you should not be seen as someone who is doing a monopoly on trade because of a particular route or anything else. So it's a very thin line to play. So you would facilitate, you would be the first ones to kind of, you know, give any discounts if it is, you know, talk about giving an X percent discount for the next 2 years for people who are preferring to move through that, etc. So you can facilitate stuff which is happening, right? But beyond that, you shouldn't. You should keep an arm's length distance. So otherwise, you know, press can talk a lot many things, like what happened, what press is talking about something which happened before even we bought the 23rd ranking terminals, right? So we could get into problems like that. So we keep an arm's length distance. But good question, yeah.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, this side.
Yeah, sorry.
Sir, how technology is used to ensure that the entire logistic and transportation services are secure in Maersk?
Right. So, I don't know whether I talked about, I think the slide talks about the evolving artificial intelligence. Please have a seat. So we started by tracking, right? I mean, of course, the courier industry used to track it much before, right? Even 5 years before, the courier packets could be tracked by just putting in your, you know, ID number, etc. But tracking a container is not easy, which means you need to have global positioning system connected to every container, not the ship, right? Which means that when a container is moved, you know, you will have challenges related to making sure that each of that. So today, we are 100% successful in making sure that the containers are tracked, which means the moment, you know, it kind of gets derouted or is beyond a particular point, you're able to. So it has helped in speed big time. It has helped in security. But, you know, I think we can do much more in terms of, I think, making it much more faster from some of the subports, which we are really working on. But security-wise, at least we have not had any major problems. There would have been one or two, you would have heard. In fact, the Maersk Alabama movie itself is made because of our story, right? I mean, I don't know how many of you saw that. So one off, there could be pirate issues. But otherwise, pretty much, because we are known for our reliability, the security comes as a part of it. But there is more and more stuff. So we are working on an Internet of Things project, which is related to the area there, which is also connected with cybersecurity. But it's a little too early for me to speak about it. But I just saw an article yesterday in the Maersk News. So I think it's a little too early, but we're definitely on that way. What else?
Yeah. Hello, sir.
Yeah, sorry, here, and then you. Yeah.
As the Indian government has relaxed FDI, what is the impact has been on the logistics business?
The exports, definitely. I mean, the moment you have investments happening in the area where the relaxation is, you would see the export happening. So that's something which we are really looking forward to, and which I talked about the GST earlier, right? So you would see, in the next 2 to 5 years, I personally feel the percentage of exports from India will definitely increase. And for us, it is import is also equally good, right? So things like that. But yes, sometimes you will have certain challenges. Like, for example, I remember 80% of the beef which went to Doha went from Mumbai, and which suddenly had stopped. If you look at the sugar, there was a time when sugar export was completely banned. So those kind of things, if your local production is not continuously, so the moment you're going to focus less on farming, this country will go through some significant issues, right? Because I'm told by 2050, the population is going to be close to 12 billion. We're close to 6 billion now, right? By 2015, we're going to be double the number of people in the world. And one of the biggest industries to grow is the food industry. And unfortunately today, 50% of what we make is wasted. In fact, if you go read the World Economic Forum report, country-wise, it talks about which country, wastes how much of food. And on average, 50% of the food is waste. So I think all of that will, optimization is going to play a very big role. And India definitely, from an export perspective, is going to grow. And we would see more and more manufacturing coming. And that will also help in, like, for example, automobiles and some of that stuff. Things are going to grow up. Yeah, yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Just one sec, first the lady and then you. Yeah, go ahead, please.
So this is Surbhi Bhargav from BIMM, HR specialization. So my question is regarding employee engagement.
Mm-hmm.
Your employees must stay on ships. So how you keep them motivated and engaged? And plus, how you appraise their performance?
Yeah. So in a ship, let's talk about the big one, right? It's called the EEE. Roughly any idea how many containers will fit on that ship? Take a guess. 8,000. 18,855 containers is what fits in one ship. Right? How many employees do you think in that ship would be there? Take a guess.
400.
3 to 400? 13. Yeah. So 13 people are, or sometimes it could be 9. The latest one needs only 9 people to run. There is technology which is being built by Rolls-Royce, a company which is in the automobile scenario, is, I think, already spent $200 million in an R&D to come out with ships without people. Remote control ships. Right? So only when it comes to very closer to the thing, someone goes and gets it to the port. Otherwise, you don't need people on the ship, right? Okay, so we are seeing significant amount of people reduction happening because of technology. Even in our shared services kind of concept, robotics process automation is happening big time. Can you imagine Infosys and Wipro, by end of this year, would have reduced 100,000 people because of RPA? I don't know how many of you all do know RPA, but one of the things, if I was you, I would do is to go and work with companies even for a week or two. Companies are Blue Prism, Automation Anywhere, and see how they are able to reduce so many hundreds and thousands of people doing the initial work, whether it is coding, or whether it is. So what it does is it gets on to your software, and if you are doing work, it will study you. Right? It will be on 10 machines. It is studying all the 10 people. And in about 2 weeks' time, 3 weeks' time, it has predicted what you do completely. And it replaces what you do on its own with the entry of whatever data goes in. So the work of 10 people overnight will be reduced to 1%. Because 90% it would have done, this 1% does a quality control, assurance, and clears off. That is why in companies, you know, so the whole technology game is big. So for HR, how do you handle employees wherein their jobs are being replaced by robots? You look at, I mean, I've had a fortune of visiting China, some of the iPhone lines. 30 to 35% of the lines are now manned by robots. Because they do more perfection of work putting an iPhone together or an iPad together, what a human being can do, which with much, much, much more of productivity. So since it is an HR question or a people question, how does one handle, which means continuous education while people are working is going to be the biggest thing if you don't keep moving. So, you know, rather than doing, you have to get into high-end analysis, analytics, predictive analytics, insight, advisory. So HR needs to play a huge role in making sure that your best of employees are moving up the value chain. And to create opportunities, to create movement, you know, and that is not an easy game when line wants predictability, when you are trying to be flexible, right? So you got to kind of, you know, cohold the people and task and then still make sure that you create a win-win. So the HR roles are going to be completely different because in our company, we have outsourced the entire HR transaction to IBM. I took over 158 HR member team 5 years before. Do you know how many HR people do I have now? 85. That's the kind of automation we have done from 158 to 85. You know, we just finished a session. So we're doing HR schools internally to make sure that, you know, the remaining people are able to significantly move up the value chain. Influencing, I mean, looking at changing structures, facilitating programs like this, those are going to be the challenges which HR will face big time. And so it's very, very important to map the industries which you're going to go into in terms of looking at what. So for us, it is about making sure that, right, for example, we declared a 4,000 people reduction in November 2015, right? The target is till end of 2017. Now, how do you do that in a very, very win-win scenario? How do you make sure that you're working with some of the corporates to move on? Luckily, most of this is in, you know, outside of India. And even in our centers, we are managing in such a way that attrition is able to manage this. At least in India, not more than 10 redundancies have done in the last 8-9 months, right? So HR has a huge role in terms of balancing things and make sure that constantly you're helping people to move up the value chain. So things like that. Sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Akshay Joshi. I'm from BIMM Marketing Executive Batch. Sir, my question is regarding point number 4, rise of machines.
Yeah.
Sir, and this is with reference to drone technology, wherein on the US part, we are seeing people getting drone licenses and the usage of drone being highly monitored. But on the Indian front, if you try to Google up on the net, there's just a paper that is dated 2013. That stops us from using drones.
Yeah.
But sir, how long do you think that the Indian scenario would be matured enough for the drone usage? And on the same lines, apart from a drone operator and its use in logistics and security, where else a drone could be used? Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so we use drones today, right? So there are a lot of ships which are working in deep seas. And a lot of material transport we used to do with smaller ships. Like Maersk supply services is one such thing. So a lot of machine parts today, which are very, very critical, right? That we are able to move through drones, right? So, but the issue in drones is you need to define the path which they would take. And governments will take time in their respective areas to define that, right? But in countries like US, it can be much more faster, right? For example, Amazon would deliver stuff locally through drones, right? So you will see all of that happening. It's just that we need to, private licenses need to be given. So the responsibility of people who run the drone needs to go significantly high, because otherwise the chances of risk or it hitting with aircrafts, those kind of things are very, very high. So unless and until the security aspect is 100% taken care, it will not. But it can still go to, you know, these kind of ship fixing and those kind of scenarios locally. But for the big things to come, it will take time.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks.
Good afternoon, sir. Yeah. Sir, to your extreme right.
Okay.
To your extreme right. Yeah.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Reva. I am from BIMM. Sir, in light of the facts that you mentioned regarding the Indian population and also the technological and the advancements that have been taken place, that are taking place rather, do you not think India is moving towards a greater disparity between underemployment and unemployment, wherein you just mentioned the facts that Infosys and other companies had to cut down their physical labor because of technology and internet and other things. You also mentioned that agents have also been reduced. So, sir, the greater part of population is still deprived of formal education like we are. So, do you think there is a greater disparity between rich and the poor and unemployed and underemployed?
Yeah. So, two things. One, INFI and Wipro are more moving new jobs. I don't think they are cutting down jobs, right? What they are doing is, you know, the kind of prediction they are going to go into the engineering colleges and recruit, that if you look at the data, has significantly come down because a lot of this kind of automation is happening. So the number which is required, which normally 2 years before the industry or a CIA or an NASCOM would have predicted, I think has come down, point number one. Point number two, I mean, unemployment is definitely there, right? I mean, whether we like it or not. But what is going to happen is that unless they really get focused in terms of what is required for the industry, you know, when I give you a statistics of 64%, by 2022, you know, doesn't have what is required, what the industry is going to demand, then who is, you know, to be blamed? It is like people in the corporate waiting for company to do training program. It can just never happen. Those are old days. You got to make sure that you sharpen your axe constantly so that the cutting can be smooth. A lot of people try do cutting. I mean, even it happens in management institutes, right? You will find a niche set of people doing stuff on their own. And that is the order of the day. I mean, I spend to the tune of 1 lakh to 5 lakh every year on me. I don't wait for the company. Right? So, people with that kind of an outlook will come out of this. But this challenge is definitely going to continue. The gap, if self-focus is not there, the gap is going to increase. But luckily, there is some good work happening in the skill council. But I'm not very sure if the money which is provided, which is runs into crores, are they really getting into that? There is significant amount of money the government of India is spending to upgradation of teachers through skill counseling, right? When I have a couple of friends who run some large establishments, like there's this guy called Rahul Ishwar, who runs this large academy, he's a known figure in Kerala. He's there with Arnab Goswami almost every other day at 9 o'clock at the news. He runs a large setup of training teacher scenario, but I am not very sure who does the quality control in terms of the best of, you know, competence gaining or proficiency level gaining. But I hope that's happening, but if that happens, then we are lucky. But I think there has to be that significant focus on self-need, because that's your insurance, right? It's like, you know, India is one of the poorest countries of people doing their own insurance. If you go to some other parts of the world, they would laugh at us. So our focus on us is very, very low in these kind of things. We are the first people to take risk and whatnot. But yeah, long answer, but I think we are able to
Thank you, sir.
It. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I am an Adi Divedi from BITM Telecom Marketing. My question is, what are the challenges and difficulties faced by the company to develop cold chain networks in our country?
Yeah.
Nowadays.
So cold chain networks, good question. That business world over is going to increase because there is going to be a lot of export and import. You can please have a seat. A lot of export and import of cold stuff. But it is not an easy market. It is a good domestic market. For example, I'm told the entire fish for the McDonald's comes from Cochin all the way, goes to the other places for the fillet fish, right? So there is significant amount of stuff happening when it comes to domestic trade. But I'm not very sure how much of that is happening from an international perspective. I know there is a lot of fruits which we import to China and India from Latin America. So many from Brazil, there is so much stuff moving. But chain as something which we really need to go. So the shipping companies do significant amount of volumes on cold chain. But that connecting to the land, I'm not very sure how good companies are there. For all you know, if we are getting into inland, which means we will ensure that we also go through and look it into those businesses. But it is a constant business. It's a very niche business. It's a constant business. It will keep improving because of the need for food, which is going to go up significantly. So, yeah.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Sumit, sir, to your left.
Yeah, left, okay.
Side. Sir, as India is an import country, which import more, so sir, how organization like Maersk recover the cost of amputee vessels which is sending back from India to the respective countries?
Yeah, so pretty much there are certain things which come in and go out. Which is called the long haul and the back haul. That's what the term is used in shipping. So most of the shipping companies and the freight guys will manage that balance, which is where cargo execution is important. Yes, sometimes if your export is not to that extent, you may have an issue. But let's understand, a ship which would bring in, let's say, automobiles, in the same ship, you can have containers. If it is going via Doha, you can move food to Doha. So most of the time, what you do is to take part loads from port to port rather than long distance, right? If you get a long distance, then you can save and make much more money. But if the reality is not there, then you have to make sure that you're able to get your network design. Shipping companies, one of the core competencies is the network design, in such a way which also makes sure that we are able to maximize from those routes. And I think fairly a good job most of these guys would do. But the crux is to do that and also ensure your reliability. So if you're able to do the balance, I think you're able to make money. Maersk, we ensure that our utilization is 90 plus, which means 90% of our ships are always loaded, right? And it's a thin line in terms of when to leave and when not to leave, just to make sure that, because otherwise, you saw that, right? 700 down in March 2016 from 6,000. So when product prices are falling like that, you still have to make the balance. Yeah?
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, my name is Vatsal Vitlani. I'm from finance specialization. So my question to you is recently European Union has asked for more transparency in shipping. And at the same time, shipping companies also seem like they are dropping prices also from Asia to Europe. So can you brief us about this?
So you talked about dropping prices and?
Transparency.
Transparency, yes, yeah. Sir. No, I think let's understand. When we move from one country to the other, you know how tough is the immigration process, right? And especially these days. So when containers move, you have to make sure that it kind of gets in with that kind of a seriousness to make sure that things are all very clear. In fact, we've just moved to the gross weight concept, VGM, if you're looking at shipping, which means that you now look at the total container weighing, which means latest weighing machines to, weigh an entire container has come into the ports. So, yes, you need to give transparency. In fact, I think the US regulations 7-8 years back looked at a series of new norms post 9/11, and the shipping industry has kind of adhered to that. So I don't think we would do any kind of compromise when it comes to anything remotely related to security. But at the same time, yes, if you are in a position to demand a unique value proposition in terms of the way you handle the goods or make sure that your reliability is the highest or your prices are the best, you will be able to get a a unique price for what you are bringing in, right? So, which is what I'm saying, you know, shipping needs to be looked at more facilitating global trade than moving containers from A to B. So, if you are able to do all of that, I'm sure, you know, you can survive as a company. But, I mean, this industry is going to be extremely, extremely exciting. Yeah, thank you. One last question. I can already see, I think, the next speaker in. So, one last question and then I'll wind up. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're asking only the half question. The rumor in the market was we are buying Hyundai, right? Yeah, so we don't have any intentions to buy Hyundai. Hyundai is significantly debt-ridden. It was almost getting into, filing Chapter 11. But so, yes, we have invited, or rather, they have requested us to be part of the 2M Alliance. Okay, in shipping, I mean, no other industry you will see. And you guys need to know, we and our competition work together, which means on a Maersk ship, I will have Maersk containers. And I also, because in 2M we have aligned with MSC, which is Mediterranean Shipping Company, their sales force also put ships containers on us. And we also do it same to their containers. And then together, transport, right? But our rates are different, our customers are different, but we make sure that the utilization is high, right? So we have invited a third party to make sure that one particular sector where they're very strong in the Korean belt, that we are able to pump in more. Because there are other similar consortiums, like for example, the Ocean 3, right, which has our CMSC, GM, and a couple of these people. So this is to balance, this is another way of consolidating. So that would happen, and I'm sure there would be new consolidations in the future. So so we three have formed, I think. There's a debate whether the 2M will become 3M or whatever. But yes, so, you know, there is so many stuff like that which have happened. We almost signed a deal with CMA, MSC, and Maersk, the top three companies, but that the Chinese government pushed back. Otherwise, it would have been called the P3 and it would have been running. So they knew that the Chinese government-owned companies will go down the drain. So they did not allow, and now they merged Costco and China Shipping. So, yeah, Alibaba is doing some wonderful e-commerce work with them. We're looking at what they will come out with. But yeah, very, very interesting. Believe you me, the moment the trade goes a little high, these companies will make billions and billions of money back again. That's what I'm saying. 2014, 2.34 billion. Right? 2015, you know, much, much lesser, 1.15 billion. Right? 2016 is going to be bad news because the industry is so, so bad. Okay. So I think I will wind up now. Thanks so much. Very, very interesting questions. You at least made sure that the energy levels are quite high. And sometimes when you get the afternoon slot, you know, I hardly saw any face which is just not even going one down like that. So appreciate the kind of energy and the enthusiasm you guys have shown. Thank you so much. All the very best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Your views on a wide range of contemporary issues, be it changing outlook of global trade, 12 disruptive technologies of future of shipping industry, challenges in shipping industry, or rise of machine. As a key to success, this knowledge would certainly enrich our learning as we march towards a brighter future.